On this episode of Latinas, we'll take a look back at some of our very best segments from this past season and so much more. Latinas starts now. Welcome to LATiNAS, the show that's all about nuestras mujeres in the Latinx community. I'm Tinabeth Piña. Anti-Asian sentiment has been on the rise in recent months, and now more than ever is it time to celebrate Asians and Asian Americans, and that celebration includes Asian Latinos. Latin Asians are a diverse group of people with different stories to tell who share a common thread that defies perceptions of race and ethnicity. Let's take a look.
My dad is half Chinese, half Cuban. My mother is full Cuban, but we grew up in a household where it was mainly Cuban, but we did keep our Chinese ancestry and our Chinese roots.
Maria Lau, a New Jersey-born and bred fine art and documentary photographer of Latin Asian descent, documented her Chinese-Cuban ancestry in the multimedia series 71.
I never thought that 71 was going to be what it became, because it really just started with the intention of finding my aunts and fulfilling this wish for my grandfather, for my family. And so it became my mission to find them. It took years, and I was able to bring them all together. It was a once-in-a-lifetime encounter that you could never replicate.
Maria is one of millions of Latinos of Asian descent, a trend with historical roots that dates back to the 16th century.
There's an uninterrupted relationship between Asia and the Americas, particularly Mexico and Peru. You know, both Mexico and Peru had ports that had this yearly trade with China, India, and Japan. That was uninterrupted between 1565 and 1815.
The Manila Galleon Trade were Spanish trading ships that sailed the Pacific Ocean for over 200 years between Spain, Acapulco, and Manila. Filipinos who were on these voyages were the first Latin Asians in the Americas and were followed in the 19th century by Indian and Chinese laborers who were brought to the Americas as part of the coolie trade.
African slaves were the most important labor force in tropical production in the Caribbean, in coastal Peru. So there were debates, you know, who was going to replace the slaves. And they thought in Indian indentured workers and Chinese indentured workers. So a large number of them are going to arrive to coastal plantations in Peru and Cuba.
Besides Cuba, Asians also migrated to Brazil, which currently has the largest number of Latinos of Japanese descent. But it's Peru that has the largest Asian population in total of any Latin American country.
If you grew up in Peru, chances are somebody in your family is of Chinese descent. It's like in there, in our blood.
Fabiana Chu, who currently lives in New York, is a fourth generation Chinese Peruvian born and raised in Lima.
But never really had to in Peru explain what it was like to be Chinese Peruvian. I was never asked, when are you going back to China? I was never asked, are you really from here? Never, never. That was never a question that I was a Peruvian in Peru. It was only once I got here that I started looking into it because people were so curious about what that meant.
Latinos come in all shapes and sizes.
Thanks for saying that. I think that means a lot to me. I'm always curious, you know, and I've always wondered, if you lined up four people, four women, and one of them was blonde, blue-eyed, and the other one had nice, beautiful brown hair with brown eyes, and there was a person, say, with some African-American features, and then you put a person who looks like me, and you lined us up, and you ask any passerby, pick the person who is not from Latin America, who do you think they would pick? And I think they might pick me. So I think we still have a lot of work to do.
While there's still much to learn about Latinidad and the various cultures that comprise it, one thing is certain. The Asian influence in Latin America is huge, and cultural pride, as well as family, is at its core, especially for Fabiana Chu and Maria Lau.
When you go on a journey like this, when you go and you find your ancestry, the most important thing that you find is yourself, your family, what's important. The more you find out about your culture, the more you find out about your history, it will affect you, it will change you.
My name is Nixa Rufino, and my son, Ken Taniguchi, who is Latino and Japanese, was recently attacked in New York City for no apparent reason, except for the fact that he is Asian American. Race-based hate is happening all too often in America and even in the heart of Manhattan. And we need to disrupt the surge of anti-Asian hate crimes. People like my son have become victims of violence based solely because of what they look like. Do whatever you can do to speak out against Asian hate and protect each other. As a mother, I am standing up for my son, and I encourage all of you to stand in solidarity with me against hate, against violence, against racism. Basta ya.
When it comes to our children, nothing matters more than their health. And autism spectrum disorders, also known as ASDs, affect up to 1 in 68 children in the U.S. over the age of 3. Dominicana and CUNY alum Yuridisi Roman shares with us how she's been tackling her son's autism diagnosis head on.
There were little signs. It started with me noticing that he wasn't speaking as much. And then, of course, every time I went to the pediatrician's office, they were like, these are his milestones. This is where he's supposed to be at. And then, you know, looking at the list they give to the parents, I was just like, yeah, there's 15 here, right? He's doing about 5 of these. I spoke to early intervention, and then I got him, you know, evaluated. That's the term. And at 18 months, they told me that he's on the autism spectrum. But there are other things there too. I grew up with attention deficit disorder. So I had my plethora of what I had to deal with. I had counseling and I had social things. So when they told me autism, I had to Google it because I didn't know what autism was. A lot of people that I've spoken to, not myself personally, have gone through the why me. That's always the first thing, why me? You shift from why me to what could have I done that this is the outcome? Then you've got that. And then it's just like, then the next one is, okay, what am I gonna do? Who's going to help me? And should I wear this proudly or should I be embarrassed?
Hi, camera. Big hug. You my big mother.
Yes, I'm your big mother. From explaining to his father what autism is, to his father denying that his son had anything wrong with him. At this juncture, 10 years later, his father and I are like, I accept it. I go with it. I get him the therapies. I got him speech therapy, occupational. And I also got him counseling because sometimes he has meltdowns, and especially in public. That's another thing. I had to educate myself. I had to deal with the emotions. I have to deal with frustration sometimes of not being understood and finding not compassionate people. In the Latino community, that's the thing. You have two different outlooks, and it's hard either way. And I find myself like I'm in the middle, like I'm educated, but I'm not unwilling to hear other stories. And also there is a part of it that I have to be a little reserved to myself about certain things. And I have to see what people are gonna come up with so I can respond. And that's hard, especially, you know, because autism is something that is in the DSM 5, the Diagnostic Statistical Manual, in English. So explain that in Spanish and then try to humanize it. If I pass on and he's not 21 yet, education wise, what's gonna happen? My son has helped me out a lot in that sense. He's taught me patience. He's taught me to live up, live. Don't be scared to be like, oh my God. No, leave un poco, loosen up. So for the future, like I said, very simple. I just want him to be independent, stay out of jail, stay away from problems, and live the best life that he can, without anybody getting hurt or without any, you know, fear of anything else.
For Latino parents with children in the spectrum, it is very important to have access to proper intervention, services, and resources, as well as community groups that support a more independent life for their children. These are some of the organizations that offer support in English and in Spanish.
'20 was one for the record books, and four Latinas from the sketch comedy group Hilarious are about to tell us what living la vida remota was like for them. And that's the topic of today's Caliente Caliente.
Restless, because I wanted to go on stage and we couldn't do that anymore. But then I took time to get on the new wave, which only strengthen my, like, I guess me as a comedian, because I got to do skits with my mom, you know, TikToks. There was nothing else to do but TikToks. And we did the Hilarious virtual show.
Can you imagine? Like, we would have still been on stage, right? Like, doing our thing. But look at the skill set that we've acquired. I'm so appreciative, just, you know, coming from that angle. We got together, collectively taught ourselves how to do it, and now we've got something so special that's digital.
A lot of great things have come out of this pandemic. Is that scary to say? Is that messed up to say? Is it mean to say?
That's not scary or bad, or that's, I feel like all of us, we have a lot of energy. We do a lot of things, especially in the beginning, to have to like be at home, to have to be still. You can feel like you're stuck, but being still is not being stuck. We're not the type of people to just sit at home. So, you know, that can be in and of itself a challenge. I've also learned that showers are kind of like the cure for everything. It's like, you know what? I'm feeling sad. I'm just going to take a shower and wash it all away. You know,
it's true. No, you're not lying. You're supposed to actually think that it's washing off all that heaviness and all that stuff. The showers is the best thing.
Latinas are able to like modulate like no other race, ethnicity can, because we flip those switches with everything in our lives. You know, we go from corporate to home life, you know, where we speak Spanish and we use curse words and stuff. Like, we modulate, you know, like there are moments during the day where I'm nothing but a mom, but I can easily flip that switch and get on a Zoom with you ladies and start, you know, talking that crazy stuff.
That was the pandemic life, Zoom meeting after Zoom meeting.
One of many things that sucks about doing Zooms is that, yeah, you can't talk when someone else is talking. And you know, when we're in the same room, we're all like talking a million miles a minute. And when somebody gets an idea, okay, I got an idea. You can't do that on Zoom. So it's like, you got to wait. And by the time you think about it, I was going to say four things. I don't forget it already.
Maybe on the bright side, people are learning to listen.
What? I didn't hear you.
What is that? Say it again?
I don't know how to listen.
That's another thing that I've had to learn during this pandemic, is how to talk to myself,
yeah,
in the mirror and say like, okay, bitch, you need to calm down. Okay. First of all, mm-hmm, breathe. Okay.
Sit down. Then breathe.
You gotta play that song in the background, you know, look in the mirror, say, bitch, I'm the best.
the beautiful thing about us is that we're freaking chameleons. Like, we will figure the ish out.
We adapt.
No matter what, we adapt.
And when the body is under stress, this is what I tell my clients. Your body, we want to take, as humans, the path of least resistance. We get stronger when our bodies and our minds, también, are under stress.
Yeah.
Some resistance to push through. That's how we get stronger. So through this process, in some, we've all gotten better and stronger in some way, shape, or form. Because we've had no choice. We've had no choice but to.
The fact that we've had to learn to adapt, it has really helped us. I know I can speak for the four of us in this room right now, that it's helped us become better women, better mothers, better friends, better at our craft, learning new crafts.
Maybe we all needed a little like recalibration, you know?
The pandemic was something good, bad for some, good for others, very much needed for all of us, because we needed that time to just like we needed to have several seats.
Yo,
Several seats,
time with ourselves, a timeout.
Isabel Allende is one of the most widely read authors in the world, having sold more than 74 million books. Allende was born in Peru to Chilean parents and first won worldwide acclaim in 1982 with her first novel, The House of the Spirits, based on a letter to her dying grandfather. Since then, she has authored more than 23 best-selling and critically acclaimed books that have been translated into over 40 languages. In addition to her work as a writer, Allende also devotes much of her time to the Isabel Allende Foundation, which she established in 1996 following the death of her daughter. The foundation supports the empowerment of women worldwide. In 2014, President Barack Obama awarded her the Presidential Medal of Freedom as she had become the world's most widely read Spanish language author. Isabel Allende is today's Badass Latina.
Have you met Tita yet? The no-nonsense South Bronx cartera and hoop-wearing New Yorican animated character whose series has gone viral on YouTube? If not, get ready to meet her and the man who created her. Elena Romero has that story.
Okay, so once upon a time, there were three bears who lived together in a house of their own.
Episode 3 of TITA went viral 1 year ago, and audiences can't seem to get enough of TITA. TITA! The no-nonsense 62-year-old married animated New Yorican created by the self-described red-headed Puerto Rican with freckles, actor-comedian Victor Cruz.
When I think back, I think I knew Tita since I was a kid. I just never knew I was going to create her later. Tita was a voice that I did for a long time. I would call and prank my friends. I would call Ricky's and then be like, Mira, do you have a costume for la nena? Because right now she wants to be SpongeBob, but none of those clothes have her size. During pandemic, I played around with the idea of animating her. And so I kind of did some research, looked around, and then I found this amazing animator who could help me. So now in my 40s, I was living my childhood dream. And that's sort of the beginnings of TITA.
Cruz says TITA reminds him of a lot of women he knows.
Ay, mira, there goes my chancleta.
TITA is a lot of women in my community growing up. Tita was the woman that if you did something wrong in the neighborhood, she was telling your mom. She was just a woman that I knew and that I know.
How did you go about deciding what Tita would look like?
I looked at pictures of people that I love. I looked at just different body types and then memories of women that I knew and buildings that I lived in growing up in the South Bronx. I know that she's always going to have her cartera and her little purse and you know, she'll always have it. Even if she's wearing her bata, getting ready to go to bed, she'd have her cartera. So it was little nuances like that that helped me kind of design her.
With familiar dichos like fíjate, presenta, and okay, Tita is everybody's favorite vecina. Living on an imaginative side street off 142nd Street near Brook Avenue in Mont Haven, Tita, who hails from Ponce, Puerto Rico, went to St. Pius Catholic School, and currently volunteers at a local hospital while working part-time as a school aide.
If you could give consejo to our Latina viewers, what would you want them to know?
Nena, this is your time, okay? You know, you've been helping so many people in your community, you've been serving, you know, helping your family, but you can't forget about yourself. You got dreams, you got, you know, aspirations and things that you wanna do. So give yourself a chance, take a moment to sit down with a little cup of coffee, un cafecito, and just think to yourself, ay, what do I wanna do? And mira, nena, go out there and do it.
For Latinas, I'm Elena Romero.
Financial advisor Maria Angeles Bonany is back to give us a bonus tip to becoming the jefa of your money.
Ladies, we are the jefas. We're the jefas at home, at work, at school, with our children, with our family. Are we the boss of our money? Now that we have the goals, we need to budget for those expenses. That budget will have to include an emergency fund. An emergency fund is a pool of money that you set aside for the por si acaso. Just in case you have a health crisis, just in case you lose your job, just in case we're in a pandemic, just in case something happens that's unexpected that we need money for. And how much should I put aside for an emergency fund? Well, a good rule of thumb is to have at least 6 months of day-to-day living expenses put aside in another separate account for the por si acasos of life.
The Latino Film Market, a female-led nonprofit organization, is celebrating its fifth annual film festival later this month. 72 Latinx films will be screened virtually, along with panel discussions and industry workshops. The week-long festival will wrap up with a weekend of in-person programming in Washington Heights and Spanish Harlem. Get your tickets and we'll see you there.
When CUNY alum Kaylynn Lopez graduated from Lehman College, she went from coffee drinker to coffee entrepreneur. And that's why she's today's Latina on the Rise.
Even in school, I would have like at least 5 cups of coffee a day to get me through. But I never anticipated ever starting a coffee business.
But she did. Back in 2019, Kaylynn started selling her Cunamonia coffee online while keeping her full-time job in retail. The brand is inspired by her double major in psychology and philosophy.
My name originated from the ancient Greek philosophical term eudaimonia, which means that you have a good indwelling spirit and overall you're happy. So I wanted to base it off of that, and my name's Kaylynn, so I added the K instead of the E to make it more distinct. And each one of my specialty roasts, they're named after different philosophers.
From Aristotle to Socrates, each roast has an inspirational quote associated with it, influenced by each philosopher's belief. For example, the medium roast is named after Socrates because of its balanced flavor, aroma, and acidity, which is said to put your mind and soul at ease. Therefore, the inspirational quote reads, "Live a life that's right for the soul."
I feel like when you have my cup of coffee and you're reading what happiness means to them, it kind of helps you start your day in a more positive mindset. And it really challenges yourself to see, hey, what does happiness mean to me? How can I start my day more happy? What can I do to make myself happy and more of a positive mindset?
Ironically, it was tough for the Bronx-born Boricua to keep that positive mindset once the pandemic hit and affected her 100% Arabica coffee business.
It affected me both good and bad. As far as the good, everything was closed. Nobody was really buying coffee anymore. They weren't going to the well-known coffee brands and everyone was ordering online. So as an online business, it really helped me with my label and I started getting more orders. My brand gained a little bit more traction, so it helped. And then it kind of went a little downhill as far as making my products and stuff because everything was delayed.
In the morning, yeah. I just need you like some coffee in the morning, yeah.
While Kaylynn hopes Curumonia gets as big as the other Bronx-born coffee brand, Café Bustelo, she is proud of what she's accomplished thus far.
To be able to be doing so well with my business, especially during such a hard time for everyone, is definitely a blessing. My parents are super happy, and they're both coffee addicts, so they love this brand. And my dad has been super supportive, so it's really nice.
Kaylynn is currently expanding her coffee brand and is also selling coffee-infused soaps and candles. She offers this philosophical advice.
One of the philosophers that I base one of my coffees off of, his name's Marcus Aurelius, and I really resonate with his theory of happiness, which is that happiness is having power over your thoughts. So for anyone who's trying to start a business, I feel like as long as you have those thoughts that you can do this and you can achieve this and you have that positive mindset, then you can really achieve anything.
And that's our show for today. For more information on what you just saw, check out our website at tv.cuny.edu and follow our social media profiles, because we love sharing our Latina stories with you. And please make sure you tune in next month, where we'll see even more great segments from season 2 of Latinas. And I don't want to brag, but we did have some great segments. ¡Uepa! ¡Hasta la próxima! Bye-bye.